questions. My only request is post lunch, please don't sleep. There's some hopes of raising money here. So bear with us for things are far better than what they were 6 months back when it comes to raising capital from investors, domestic and international bond. So things are very different, times are changing. That is also reflected, particularly when we talk about steel as a sector, in the recent increase in some of the market cap of large steel making companies. We are seeing a trend where not only the traditional trade finance investors, but also a new breed of investors who are willing to put in risk capital to help some of the businesses to come out of the current stress situation, are willing to write checks, are willing to go through difficult times with some of these companies and help them to revive. Before I get into the presentation, just a small introduction about Brescon. We are an 18-year-old boutique advisory firm specializing in special situations, which includes distress and pre-stress. We help companies with financial restructuring, we help companies to raise risk capital, we help companies to work out settlement packages with banks and other creditors. We have been doing it for last 18 years and proud to claim we are the longest serving independent private advisor in this space. And over this 18 years period, we would have worked for over 250 to 300 corporates across sectors, across different kind of situation and different size of businesses from small to large. At the moment, the firm is very focused on tapping into new sources of capital, helping many of the commodity companies, whether steel, cement, power, to raise finance from the non-conventional banking sources. Coming to the fundraising part of it, I think subject given was what are the different routes of raising funds for the three sectors mentioned there. Before we get into different categories of investors which we see in the market, I think it is important to touch upon the thought process, the way the sectors are being analyzed by the investing community. So we have just put a simple metrics to make the point. So I think there are two points which are common across the sectors. One is they are all capital intensive businesses with relatively longer gestation period. Number two is somewhere they are also either highly regulated but not light on regulation. Particularly when it comes to accessing the raw material, which is very key for the success of all three businesses. The differentiating factor between these three, when we see from investors' perspective and the challenge they face while evaluating these businesses, are, if we take the first one, steel as a sector, basically they feel the destiny of the business largely gets driven by external factors and particularly global factors, because the selling price depends upon that. Whereas the domestic cost is concerned in terms of its mining cost, in terms of its power cost, in terms of labor cost, in terms of logistic cost, most of it remains the same with some element of inflation there. But the economics are largely driven by global factors, and it becomes very difficult for them to assess in which way the realization in the steel industry is going to go. So it becomes very difficult for them to take a view on, you know, their investment horizon, which could be 3 to 5 years, 7 years and so on. This is unlike cement and power, which is very domestic oriented, and also particularly power, very regulatory driven, both in terms of the input cost and the realization is the power tariff. So in that sense, between steel, cement and power, if one has to kind of get into a rating from the external factors or external dependence perspective, investors generally prefer looking at cement followed by power, then followed by steel. Similarly, if you look at financial metrics, which is how much returns this businesses have delivered to investors in the past. Also, if you look at some of the deals which have happened in the past, the history would indicate, suggest, steel is one such sector where investors have hardly made any returns out of their investment. Whereas cement is concerned, it has always rewarded investors and therefore they are willing to reinvest in that sector. And whereas power is concerned, it's a mixed bag, therefore you see a more efficient market. Just to share some of the examples, if you see the business economics, we have just taken top three players in each segment and put some numbers here which are available in public domain. Steel is a business which is single digit on ROE. And many of sitting here, also the people I have been meeting during the lunchtime, a lot of steel players expect private investment. The question which we have to ask ourselves is, if we get a private investment in form of equity, how we are going to generate adequate return and reward that investor? So if you look at even the larger players, the return on equity has been in single digits. When you compare this with cement, as I said, between the three sectors, it is cement which is, relatively more attractive for private investors, you will find the returns over a period of time has been quite decent. And power is a mixed bag, which is a combination of single digits, double digits, and so on. Even if you look at some of the deals which have happened in this segment, many of the past deals, if we take cement, if we take steel as an example, investors have lost money. I have not got into putting the IRR numbers here, but the fact is, if you take all the four, I think without an exception, all the four names given below, with more than 5 years of investment now, every investor has lost money in all these four cases. If you take examples as steel, you'll find relatively more deals happening in steel on the private side in last 2 to 3 years. And if you look at some of the historical deals, in most of the cases, investors have made money. So therefore, you see more capital flowing to cement compared to steel. Categories of investors, we have bucketed them into five. This is excluding opportunity available to companies to raise capital from capital markets, either through IPO, either through QIP, FPO, and so on. So that's a category which debt available from the banking system. So therefore, we are talking about opportunities to raise capital from five categories of investors which are other than this. The first category is the non-banking finance companies. These are all privately held finance companies. Some of the names being illustrated there. They are all looking at investing, even if it's a commodity business. We'll get into what kind of deals, what structures they prefer in the subsequent slide. Similarly, we see a lot of structured credit and special situation funds which have come in are very aggressive. They are again a combination of global investors and some of the domestic investors. Then particularly in case of stress situations, we have asset reconstruction companies which are active. They do help some of the companies to reduce the leverage part of it by buying out debt and then getting into negotiation to settle. Then we have some of the funds which are very, very focused on the infrastructure side, and they've been investing for quite some time. And then we have some of the private equity funds which are being active, particularly on the commodity side. Coming to, having said, there are five categories of investors, and some of the illustrations where is the names of the investors are concerned. Coming to what is their preference, so if you take equity as a source of capital, as an instrument to be issued for inviting capital. If you look at between steel, cement, power, the preferences are very different, the evaluation criteria are very different. So if you take, say for example, steel as a sector, they would typically prefer investing in niche products. They would prefer investing in businesses which are fully integrated on the raw material side, on the finished goods side, and preferably they also have a captive power for the reasons we discussed before. Otherwise, the ROEs are generally single digit. It becomes difficult for business to generate equity returns and reward investors within 3 to 5 years. So, therefore, they prefer this as a filtration criteria. So, therefore, what they don't like is investing in carbon steel manufacturing with no integration. They don't prefer investing in businesses which are suboptimal, and generally 1 million ton is taken as a cutoff to define what is suboptimal, number of plants available, no buyers. And when it comes to stress side, generally they prefer operating plants, and they don't want to go anywhere close to businesses which are shut, because they don't want to take a combination of a financial stress and getting into reviving a closed unit. When it comes to cement, in terms of filtration criteria compared to steel, relatively simpler. It should be a decent brand, so therefore has a customer base, and they should see a growth story in terms of a brownfield or a greenfield expansion possible with some kind of infrastructure being in place. So they would not invest a completely new greenfield project, but if it's a brownfield kind of expansion with certain infrastructure, further capacities can be added and so on, so that would be their preference, so that there's a growth story and one can make returns on equity. What is important again in cement, we have seen some of these situations where there's a bit of challenge on logistic side, and logistic cost is something which is very, very critical in cement. It's a kind of a regional business. We don't know in which way the realization would move over a period of time, so therefore controlling logistic cost is very, very critical. And of course, as I said at the beginning, whereas all these three businesses are concerned, there has been learning for the industry, for the investor. Access to raw material is very, very critical. When it comes to power, a lot of opportunities in the market, but the biggest challenge is, as I said, it's highly regulatory driven. So you don't control your revenue, you don't control your cost. So therefore, to get a sense on that, you need to have a PPA and FSA in place. So that's the biggest challenge, and in many of the situations we see currently, the PPA is not in place. But if the PPA is in place, there is a FSA, there are solutions possible, there is a capital sitting somewhere, if you're linked to putting structures in place and put capital to work. One of the other challenges in power sector, a lot of projects which are not complete. But having said that, if there is a PPA and the projects are complete to an extent of 70 to 80%, investors are willing to take that last mile execution risk. A complete greenfield project at the moment, given what the demand situation is, it's a complete no-no with the investor community. That was more on the equity side of fundraising. Coming to structured debt, which is also a trend in the market as of now, and we find more investors on structured debt side compared to equity investment. So on the structured dead side, when it comes to steel in particular, the preference always has been to look for priority debt because they want the internal accruals to help them in getting an exit for the reason which I mentioned at the beginning. Equity returns, equity exit is a bit of a challenge. So therefore, if you can get an exit from the operational cash flow, they are willing to look at putting in priority debt. But the challenge on priority debt at the moment in the market has been the existing lenders are not willing to cede a priority charge, a superior charge in favor of a new investor coming in. But at the same time, we are seeing a trend where bankers are willing to engage on that subject, they are willing to jointly find a solution around it. And going by some of the media reports, there are deals in pipeline. Hopefully, we should see some announcements happening soon. Coming to cement, better options compared to steel. In cement, as I said, capacity expansion, both in form of equity and structured credit, is an option. In addition to that, people are willing to look at doing promoter funding in cement business. People are also willing to look at investing through a debt instrument even if it is not a priority position. We have seen a couple of cases last year, Piramal Group investing in two large cement businesses from Hyderabad, Sanghi Cement and NCL, which are structured credit, they use of money being to pay the compens to the existing lenders and so on. Coming to power again, there could be an opportunity to refinance some of the existing debt. Again, depending upon situation to situation, both the options are possible. Some of the plants may be eligible to replace high cost with low cost. And in certain cases, there could be a compulsion to still go for a high cost kind of refinance. And then of course, a promoter lending and last mile is something which is an option. But the common thread between all the three, even if it's a structured debt with security, with protection of the cash flow side, funding a new greenfield project at the moment is a complete no-no with the investors. Coming to distress situations, there are opportunities there. Investors which specializes in distress investing, special situation funds in particular, are willing to look at proposition across all the three segments. Whereas steel is concerned, the challenge at the moment they are facing is too many unviable, suboptimal opportunities, and even if the debt gets settled at deep discount, still investors find it very difficult to work out exit option with those suboptimal capacities, because in an unfortunate event of company not able to repay, the challenge they have is how they are going to dispose of this business, because there are no organized buyers for suboptimal capacities in the market. So therefore, from that perspective, there is a limited interest in suboptimal capacity from stress funds. Having said that, businesses which are relatively large, integrated, there are investors who are willing to look at investing in distressed steel businesses. Coming to cement, as I said, multiple deals have got closed. In a way, it's a good thing for the sector. There are hardly any distress opportunities left there. It would be only single digit out of some 100 plants operating in the country, unlike steel, where one should not hesitate to just make a statement, maybe 80% of the steel businesses are under distress. But in cement, a complete turnaround has happened. Businesses which were struggling have got funding in last couple of years' time. There could be only 2 to 3, maximum maybe 5 opportunities left in the market which are looking for private source of capital. coming to power, a very, very complicated subject, you know, all sorts of assets, suboptimal, no PPA, no FSA, some plants are complete, some plants are operational, but no cash flows, so a very, very complicated animal as of now. But on a very, very selective basis, there are investors who are willing to look at even distressed power assets. I think the challenge across all the three segments when it comes to distress is pricing it right. Most of the companies, most of the investors today are facing an issue with the lenders who are not in a position to get into taking substantial haircuts. And unless we see those haircuts getting accepted by the lending community, it would be difficult for the private capital to come in. But we are very hopeful. It's a matter of time, maybe you know another few months, particularly with the insolvency law being introduced in the month of December. I think the government is very committed to find resolution to stress situation in the banking industry. And across these three sectors, we are seeing a lot of interest from investors, both domestic and foreign investors. Of course, the interest is for certain size of businesses, businesses at certain status of operations and so on. But there is a private capital which is waiting to get invested in these businesses. And hopefully we'll see resolution in the banking industry sooner. And we'll also see businesses getting revived. I think if I have to summarize, you know, when we talk about, you know, finding sources of capital, when we talk about many of the businesses being under a distress situation and so on. The fundamental question which I have for the entire finance community is, are we going to repeat the cycles in future? Steel in particular, cement in particular, we have seen numerous cycles where these businesses get into distress, the lenders have to take haircut, the same set of entrepreneurs come back doing the business and so on. So somewhere there is a fundamental flaw in the entire financing structure which is happening in this segment. You know, we can't, you know, do away with some of the peculiarities we have for these businesses, particularly in our country. There would be commodity cycles, and commodity cycles, some of it could be domestic, it could be global. Some of these businesses, given that they are very capital intensive, long gestation period, there would be low return on equity, therefore raising equity would be a bit of a challenge when it comes to implementing the greenfield projects. So the question is, if these businesses have to survive for long and they have to have access to low cost funding, and if they have to also grow in future by expanding their existing capacity, what is the best source of capital available? In our old you know, financial system industry, we used to have development financial institutions. We used to have IDBI, we used to have IIBI, we used to have IFCI, ICICI. Today we don't have any development financial institution even for large capital intensive businesses which need access to long-term and low-cost funding. So that's a challenge I believe in front of the industry and also in front of the government to resolve, rather than looking at short-term measures of creating private funding to de-stress this sector. Thank you very much.